by Dr. Ram Narayanan. He has done his undergraduate from Trivandrum Medical College and MCH Neurosurgery from NIMHANS, Bangalore. And he's specialized in restorative functional neurosurgery, especially in Parkinson's, Tourette syndrome, spasticity, cerebral palsy, autism. He's a consultant functional neurosurgeon in many hospitals of Chennai, Bangalore, Delhi, Doha, Muscat, Kuwait, and Mali. There are many awards and achievements to his accreditation, prominent of them being the gold plaque by the National Neurosciences Center, Muscat, Achievers Award Gold Medal by National Integrity Academy, Best Doctor Award by Tamil Nadu MGR University. He's an International Fellow of American Association of Neurological Surgeons, Vocational Excellence Award by Rotary Club Chennai, and his special interest being epilepsy surgery for intractable epilepsy, and he conducts freely of them for cerebral palsy children in collaboration with the Rotary Club Ambattur. He has helped many cerebral palsy children and Parkinson patients. And there are many surgeries. I think through WhatsApp groups, he keeps sharing all his pre-op and post-op videos. Now he's going to talk a beautiful topic, that is neurosurgery for autism. Over to you, Dr. Ram Narayan. Ram Narayan, sir.
He was there. Let me search for him.
Yes, sir.
He is not there, sir. I'm not able to find him.
What time just a minute ago?
Let me call him.
Yes, sir.
Ram, can you log in? Your talk is on.
Sir, Priya here, sir. Sir, Ram Narayan, sir, had called. He had some issue. It got stuck. So I've asked him to log in again, sir.
Please log in back. Thank you. Okay. He's having network issue as well. So he's logged out. He's logging back in.
Hello, I'm sorry, Sandeep. There was some problem. I had to also log out and log in again. Sorry about that.
Please go ahead. Please share your screen.
Yeah.
If you're ready, we are okay.
Yeah. I'm ready. I'm slowly. One. Yes, sir.
Sir, meanwhile, there is a question in the chat box being orthopedic related question. I think I can answer the question. Dr. Arun Karnan has logged out. The question is posted as, wasn't the hip joint also having osteoarthritis too? And if there is any concurrent hip osteoarthritis, what should be done? Dr. Ram Narayan, if you don't mind, can I take a minute, sir?
Definitely, why not?
Actually, in such cases, hip joint being a ball and socket joint, definitely the amount of osteoarthritis in hip will be much lesser compared to the knee joint. Even though with such a deformity, being a ball and socket joint, the cartilage is evenly spread out. So the amount of hip OA will be less. If there is any concurrent hip osteoarthritis, probably he may be require hip replacement. But later on, we need to correct the major deformity, which is at the knee joint. And we have to wait for at least 6 months to have the complete recovery from the knee joint surgery and then assess his hip joint status. If the patient does complain about hip joint pain and if there is any range of movement decreased, probably we should contemplate hip replacement also. But, many a times, almost 95-98% of times, they won't be requiring any hip replacement as such. I hope I have answered your question, Dr. Lalit. Yes, sir, Dr. Ram Narayan, you can take over, sir.
Thank you. Sorry, there was some confusion because, you know, the whole screen got stuck and then, you know, as advised by this thing, I had to log out and then log in again. So, sorry for the delay.
This is common. So, don't worry. It happens in every meeting to everybody.
Okay. Okay. So, I'll be talking about a surgery for autism. That is a DBS of the amygdala for autism. This was done about a year back. And you know, we always wait for up to 1 year for seeing the full clinical improvement. So we have last March we did the surgery, and this March we had full patient assessment. And then I am just presenting my the case report on this. So just autism or autism spectrum disorder refers to a broad range of conditions characterized by challenges in social skills, repetitive behaviors, speech, and nonverbal communication. It is seen in 54 children in 54 children in the US, and India it is seen in around 0.11% of the children in the rural areas and 0.09% in the urban areas. So as I'm sure all of you know the symptoms, intense focus on one item, lack of understanding social cues, repetitive movements or self-abusive behavior like head banging, learning to speak relatively late, all these things. In fact, as the patient grows up, the aggressive behavior becomes one of the biggest problems that the parents cannot control. Studies have found that 1 in 4 children with autism show aggressive behavior, such as hitting others, destroying property, throwing temper tantrums, and all that. Children with significant aggressive behavior also tended to have mood and anxiety symptoms, difficulty in sleeping and paying attention. The studies indicate that symptoms of aggression overlap in patients with extreme anxiety and attention deficit issues. So my patient was a 28-year-old male with severe autism and aggressive behavior. In fact, both the parents are retired government doctors in Kerala, and they know they were having a lot of difficulty in controlling this man because, you know, he was very well grown. He was around, say, more than 6 feet high, very physically very strong fellow. These are the assessments which we made. Parameters in the parameters here are given for the first 3 months. The first scale which I did was the Indian scale for assessment of autism. This is the standard thing which is used in all over in the country, which includes social relationship and reciprocity, emotional responsiveness, speech, behavior patterns, sensory aspects, and cognitive components. The score was 163 out of 200 before surgery, and it became 97 out of 200 after surgery. Of course, you know, I'll show the recent thing. This is after 3 months. So severe AD is above 155. Severe autism disorder is above 155. The next one we did is a CAR score. It's a preoperative score was 49 out of 60 and postoperative is 21 out of 60. This CAR score is from 15 to 60 and it is can label different mild to moderate and severe autism. And scores are based on direct observations. The next thing we did is a global assessment of functioning, which preoperative was 20 to 11. And postoperative has become 60 to 51. That is mild to moderate symptoms. This is a modified overt aggression scale where we assess the amount of aggression that the patient shows. It includes verbal aggression, aggression against property, auto aggression, physical aggression. The score was 26 in the pre-op period, and post-operative period it became 1. So practically became very quiet and very nice chap. Psychometry showed attention span of less than minute pre-operatively. Now it has increased to more than 12 minutes. The other scale which we did is autism diagnostic observation scale, which has 4 modules, and the pre-op is, I can see it is the after 6 months, the scale has improved in some of the parameters. In the last few decades, there has been increasing interest in the role of amygdala in psychiatric disorders, and in particular, its contribution to the socio-emotional impairment in autism spectrum disorders. Several theoretical explanations compatible with amygdala and its presence has been proposed. The human amygdala is a critical component of a brain circuit involved in the appraisal of self-relevant events that include social stimuli. So this is the amygdala. This is a medial temporal lobe. You can see here, this is the medial temporal lobe. This is the amygdala. This is the corpus callosum with nucleus like this. Radiologically, this is how it looks like, the medial temporal lobe. And the amygdala, again, has got multiple nuclei. And what we are interested for our surgery was the basolateral nucleus, which we've shown here. And this is the pathway of my surgical pathway. Studies have reported neuroanatomical differences between individuals with ASD and controls, including changes in the relative size of the amygdala. An analysis of MRI from 8 children found that sizes of the right and left amygdala related to total brain volume were increased in toddlers with ASD. Another study demonstrated both amygdala volume and microstructure of connections between the amygdala and the cortex are altered in ASD. So that means amygdala has a big role in autism spectrum disorder. Going through the literature, there have been 3 reports previously before I did my surgery. First one was done by Sturm in 2012. He did DBS, that is deep brain stimulation, to a patient with Cannon's autism. The electrodes were placed in the basolateral nucleus of the amygdala. After 24 months, the self-induced behavior and core symptoms of autism spectrum improved. Another study by Segar reported beneficial effects of same thing, the severe autism. 3 years after placement of the disc, the patient continued to show improvements in their behavior. The Stokoe mentioned 2 patients. The first patient is a 19-year-old woman whose Hopkins motor stereotype rating scale decreased by 91.3%. But however, the second patient, an 80-year-old man, he had initial improvement, but after some time, the improvement deteriorated. Actually, he deteriorated, and in fact, I was told personally that he died. These cases illustrate that DBS may be possibly effective treatment for patients with ASD. DBS of the amygdala may be more valuable for ASD patients with predominantly social dysfunction and self-induced behavior, whereas ASD patients with compulsive behavior or stereotype must benefit more from stimulation of the striatal areas. This is just a note which the mother gave me after 3 months. You can see, as I told you, the mother is an ophthalmologist. So she made a list of things which has improved. Aggressive behavior, very aggressive before, no more aggressive. Toppling of objects, toppled some huge and small things, only toppling a small object. In fact, now after 1 year, it has stopped everything. Sleep, very much disturbed previously, now the sleep is much better. Pushing down persons, in fact, you know, he used to push down persons and he caused head injury in one man so serious that it became a legal issue. He doesn't push anybody now. Eating habits, appetite had increased earlier, but his appetite is now regularized. Speech has improved. Personal high interactions has improved. Normal intelligence seems to have improved. Cleanliness has improved. So the doctor says that our family is happy after DBS. That is what they said. This is the postoperative CT scan. If you can see, these are the 2 electrodes. And of course, the medial temporal lobe. So I put the electrode in the medial temporal lobe, both the electrodes. At 1 year follow-up, you can see, compare, you know, the ISAA was 163 pre-op, 6 months, 97, after 1 year is 36. CARS has become, 49 has become 60. GAF has become 70 to 61. MOES has become, it is actually 1. Attention concentration has increased up to 12 minutes. The other scales have all improved. So in fact, you know, I had made a video in which the parents told me that the patient has improved by 90%. This is their assessment, whereas my assessment is 70% improvement. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ramnarayan, for the beautiful presentation, and the feedback from the patients was very encouraging, actually. Okay. Are there any questions from the audience? I think that is crystal clear presentation, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Can you stop your screen share, sir?
Yeah. Okay.